Good afternoon, students. I welcome you all for the class. Today, we are going to discuss regarding RAM and ROM chips. So it is one of the important topic in the third unit, that is memory organization. So when we are going to talk regarding this memory organization, so a memory in the sense storing of data, as we have discussed all the things in the introduction part, right? So when we are going to do the storing of any data, so we have to store it in the RAM or ROM, right? So, and we have seen what is RAM and what is ROM, everything we have seen in the previous classes. So today we will be going to discuss regarding how the RAM chip will be, what are the pins that are going to be available in the RAM chip, and what is a ROM chip, the pins that are going to be available in the ROM chip, and memory address mapping and memory connection to CPU. So these are the things that are going to be discussed in this today's class. So when we are going to come to this RAM chip, so the RAM chip will be like this. So this is the RAM chip. So here for the RAM chip, you will be going to have four pins. The first two pins are used for chip select one and chip select two. In short, we are going to call it as CS1 and CS2 bar. So why we have indicated bar, in the sense it is a complement. If it is zero, we have to take it as a one. And if it is one, we have to take it as a zero. So that is the indication for the complement. So here we are going to take this 128/8 RAM. So what do you mean by this 128/8 RAM? So 128/8 RAM, in the sense here we are going to have 128 words of 8-bit capacity. So that's the that is the reason we call it as 128/8 RAM. Fine. Here the chip select, the RAM chip is better suited for communication with the CPU. And it is one of the important control inputs for the select of chip. So that is the main purpose of this RAM chip. Fine. So when we are going to talk regarding this RAM and ROM chips, we need to keep that in mind, that like we need to have a storage purpose of data. So whether we have to store the data in a RAM or whether in the ROM, it may be of a different purpose. So according to our flexibility, we are going to store the data. So that is how we will be going to consider. So here the RAM chip is classified into two possible modes, the static mode and the dynamic mode. Fine. So RAM chip is divided into two modes, static mode and the dynamic mode. So what do you mean by static mode and what do you mean by dynamic mode? So when we are going to talk regarding the static mode of the RAM, so see here, this is the RAM chip. So this RAM chip can be of static mode. ఇది కనెక్ట్ చేశాం కదా, ఇది వేరే స్లైడ్ మూవ్ అవుతుంది టచ్ చేస్తుంటే. అవునా, వీళ్ళ కెట్ట వరసలు పెట్టేసి పెన్న అలవాటు అయిపోయింది. అవును, పాయింటర్ ఆప్షన్స్ వచ్చింది. పెన్ అంటే చూసాను, స్లైడ్ మారుస్తుంటే పోతుంది,
వర్కింగ్ అన్నమాట.
పెన్ వర్కింగే, పెన్ ఇదే రాస్తుందా? ఎట్లా వేడ పెట్టుకోవాలి. So here, if you see this, this is the RAM chip we are having. So in this RAM chip, we'll be going to have different pins, right? Here you can see. So chip select one, chip select two bar, RD in the sense, read, WR in the sense, write. And here AD7 in the sense, this is a combination of address and data. So AD0 to AD7 it will be. So A indicates address, D indicates data. So this is the RAM chip. So as I have said you, this RAM chip is classified into two possible modes. So what are the two possible modes in the sense? The first one is static mode and the second one is dynamic mode. So static mode and the dynamic mode. Here, when we are going to talk regarding the static mode, this static mode is or static mode or static RAM, it is made up of flip-flops. Static RAM is made up of flip-flops. What this flip-flop is going to do is it is going to store the binary information. So what is the binary information? 0 and 1. So the flip-flop is the one which is going to store the binary information, that is 0 and 1. So here, when we are going to talk regarding the static RAM, here the nature of the static RAM is volatile. What do you mean by volatile? That is like it remains valid as long as the power is applied to the system. The data will be there only when the power is applied to the system. That we call it as an volatile. Here, the static RAM is very easy to use and it is going to take less time in performing the read and write operations when compared to the dynamic RAM. So that is regarding the static RAM. So when we are going to talk regarding this dynamic RAM exhibits the binary information in the form of electric charges. So, in the form of electric charges, these electric charges are applied to the capacitors. So, the capacitor has a tendency of charging and discharging, right? So, capacitor has a tendency of charging and discharging. So, when we are going to talk regarding the static RAM, in static RAM, we have make use of these flip-flops. When it comes to the dynamic RAM, we are going to make use of this capacitors. So the capacitors are integrated inside a chip by this transistor. So here, the advantage of this dynamic RAM is it is going to consume less power and it provides a large storage in a single memory chip. So these are the advantages of RAM chip, right? These RAM chips are, we are going to have a different sizes as per the system requirement. So we are going to have the 128/8 RAM chip. So this is the example of 128/8 RAM chip, right? The chip which I'm going to show is an example of 128/8 RAM chip. So here, a 128/8 RAM chip has a memory capacity of 128 words of 8 bits. 120 words of 8 bits. That's the reason We are calling it as 128 by 8. So this requires 7-bit address and then 8-bit bidirectional data bus. So here 7-bit address we are going to require, and this is a bidirectional 8-bit data bus. So this is the functionality of a RAM chip. So here, what is the purpose of this 8-bit bidirectional data bus is, this data bus allows the transfer of data either from the memory to CPU during a read operation or from CPU to memory during the write operation. So we are going to perform only the read and write operations, right? So when we are going to perform this read and write operations, so here, this 8-bit bidirectional data bus is used to transfer the data either from memory to CPU when during the read operation, or from memory to CPU during the write operation. So these are the two things that we can do by making use of this 8-bit bidirectional data bus. Here, this bidirectional data bus is using is constructed using a three-state buffer. What are the three states in the sense? High, low, and high impedance state, or else 0, 1, and high impedance state. What do you mean by high impedance state? High impedance state in the means, in high impedance state, the circuit acts as an open circuit. When the circuit is open, no data is going to be transferred in and out of this RAM chip. So this is regarding this RAM chip. So here, the chip selects what we are having, the chip select 1 and chip select 2. So these are the selection inputs. Chip select 1 and chip select 2 are the selection inputs. What are the need of this selection inputs are known as. So these are used to select the particular chip when the memory is going to be enabled, fine. So that is the purpose of the selection chip. The read and write input specifies the memory operation, whereas the CS control inputs are used for enabling the chip only when the select, when it is going to be selected by the microprocessor. That is the functionality of this chip select 1 and chip select 2. So you may have got a doubt that why we need two chip selects, only one RAM is there, why CS1 and CS2 bar is there. So the availability of more than one input to select the chip facilitates that. Suppose if decoding an address lines when multiple chips are used in the microprocessor. So that is the thing why we have been used two chip selects over here. So when we are going to decode multiple inputs, so these chip select 1 and chip select 2 are going to be used. Instead of having one, we are going to have two. So read input in the sense, we are going to read the data. Write in the sense, we are going to write the data. And 7-bit address here, as I have mentioned, that AD7. AD7 in the sense, it is a multiplexing of address and data bus. Why? Because at only one time we are going to make use of either address or data. We can't use both address and data at the same time. So if you are going to make the 7 address lines separately and 7 data lines separately, it will be very much complicated. So in order to reduce that complexity, what we are going to do is, here we are going to multiplex the address and data lines. So if you are going to transfer the address lines are going to be activated. And if you are going to do with the data lines are going to be activated. So that is the reason of this multiplexing address in the data bus. So here, when CS1 is equals to 1 and CS2 bar is equals to 0, obviously, right? So here, if I keep 1 over here, CS1 is 1. So CS2 will be 1 bar is nothing but 0. So the memory can be placed in a write or read operation, fine? So in write or read operation, it will be going to do. So when the WR input is enabled, that means when the write input is enabled, the memory stores a byte from the data bus into the location specified by the address input lines. Fine, that is the use of the write. So when the read input is enabled, what the thing it will be going to happen is, the content of the selected byte is going to be placed in the data bus. So the read and write signals control the memory operation as well as the buses. So that is the purpose of this read and write. So here the ROM chip is organized externally in a similar manner, like RAM, how the RAM is going to be done, like that the ROM is also going to be externally, which is going to be emulated. So this is regarding the RAM chip. So here we are going to see the next we are going to see the table of this RAM chip, right? So here in this RAM chip, like we have been used four RAMs over here. So four RAMs in the sense here, four RAMs we have been used and one ROM we have been used. So this is the thing we are going to do. Just wait a moment. Yeah, so the RAM 1, RAM, the first four are RAM 1, 2, 3, 4, and the last one is the ROM. So here the memory functions are going to be written over here. See here, 0, 0 in the sense, CS1 is 0, CS2 in the sense, it will be 1. Here we are not doing any operation. Inhibit state in the sense, high impedance state. That means no data is going to be transferred. So here, if you are going to place 0 in the sense, here it will be 1. When read and write inputs are not enabled, it will be also again in the high impedance state. So here, CS1 is 0 and CS2 is 0. So if both are zeros in the sense, both will be in the high impedance state, right? So here, when the turn comes in the sense, when any one of the input, that is read input or the write input is enabled, then only we'll be going to activate over here. See here, write input is 1. So then the memory is going to do the write operation. Write operation in the sense, it will be going to input the data to the RAM. So that is the write operation. Here, when we are placing a 1 in the read option in the sense, it is going to perform the read operation. Read operation in the sense, output data to the RAM. So when we are going to have a read and write, then only it is going to do an operation with the memory. And in remaining all cases, it is going to be in the high impedance state. What do you mean by high impedance in the state? In the sense, it is not going to perform any action. Why? Because the data or the information is not going to be flown into the system. So that is the high impedance state. So that is regarding the RAM chip. So when we are going to talk regarding this ROM chip, so here this is the ROM chip. ROM chip is going to have 512/8. So RAM is going to have, like as I have said you before, RAM is going to have 128/8 and ROM is going to have 512/8. So here you will be going to have RAM chip and also the ROM chip. This ROM is also used for storing the data. So when we are going to talk regarding this ROM chip, so the primary component or the of the main memory is what we say it is a RAM chip. But what are the tasks that are going to be done when we are going to make use with the ROM chip in the sense? So it is a similar organization as RAM chip. Nothing is different, similar to ROM chip. So here ROM can perform only read operation. That is the only change we can do. Only read operations are going to be done. So here the database can only operate in the output mode, not the input mode. So output mode only it will work. So these are the characteristics of ROM chip. Here we are going to have 9 address lines. Previously we will be going to have 7 address lines, right? So when we are going to talk with the ROM chip, we are going to have 9 address lines. So this 9-bit address lines in the ROM chip specify any one of the 512-bit stored in the memory. So here the value of chip select 1 and chip select 2 must be 1 and 0. So if it is 1, this must be 0 in order to operate the unit. Otherwise, the database is set to be in high impedance state. Fine. So that is regarding this ROM chip. And next one is memory address mapping. So when we are going to talk regarding this memory address mapping, so here the addressing of memory can be established by means of a table that specifies the memory addressing. So what is the table demonstrates? What is the table demonstrates in the sense here? This is the table. This table is going to demonstrate like what are the things that are going to be happen. So this is the memory address map. How we are going to address the memory with the buses. Here we are going to have the component field. Here the component column specifies whether a RAM chip or ROM chip has to be used. Fine. Here the component is going to be specified for to use the RAM chip or ROM chip. So that is the purpose of this component. Here the hexadecimal address. This column assigns a range of hexadecimal equivalent address for each chip. Fine. Here the address bus lines are listed in the third column. This is the third column which we have listed over here. Here, although there are 16 lines, as we all know, although there are 16 address bus will be there, but here we have mentioned only 10 lines because the other six we are not using here. So that's the reason we have mentioned only 10 address lines. Here, this small x, what are this x is going to do is, this x under the address bus lines tells that those lines must be connected to the address input of each chip. So that is the purpose of this x. And the ROM chip has 512 bytes and needs 9 address lines, right? So 9 address lines must be needed by the ROM chip. The X are always assigned to lower order bus lines. So that is the mandatory. So it is now necessary to distinguish between 4 RAM chips by assigning each different address for a particular. So for example, we choose the bus lines of 8 and 9 to represent distinct binary information. So here, so this 8 and 9 lines, 0, 1 in the sense 1. 0, 1, 2, and 3. So 0, 1, 2, and 3. This binary information is used for storing the address. So here, the distinction between the RAM and the ROM address is done with another bus line. So that is the purpose of this is in order to distinguish both the RAM and the ROM. Here, the equivalent hexadecimal address for each chip is obtained from the information under the address bus assignment. So that is the thing we have done in the memory address mapping. So how we are going to map the address with the memory so that we show it as a memory address mapping. See, that is the reason why we are going to make use of both RAM and the ROM chips. Okay.
Did you subscribe to my channel?
You have not gave lollipop to me now. How can I subscribe? Huh? పులిహోర తెచ్చాను ఇవాళ. ఎక్కడ పొద్దున్నే వాళ్ళకి టిఫిన్ చేసి వస్తున్నాను కదా. ఏమోనమ్మా ఎప్పుడు ఎక్కుతారు, మొన్నే వెళ్ళిపోతానన్నారు. సరే ఇంకా బెన్నిగాడి పుట్టినరోజు ఉంది, మళ్ళీ తర్వాత రేపు 21st ఏమో మా చిన్నోదిన వాళ్ళ కూతురు పుట్టినరోజు ఉంది. మా జీవితం వచ్చేసింది అసలు, అన్ని రోజులు ఎట్లా ఉంటారో కూడా అర్థం కాదే బాబు. ఒక 5 మినిట్స్ అయిపోతుంది. నేను పోలే, నిన్న వెళ్ళాను ఆ బయట గూర్చి చూసే బయటకు వచ్చేసాను. అవును చెప్తున్నాను. And next the topic is memory connection to CPU. So here when we are going to talk regarding this memory connection to CPU, the RAM and ROM chips are connected to CPU through the data and the address buses. Here you can find the data and the address buses, right? So here we will be going to have the address bus and here we are going to have the data bus. So here the lower order lines in the address bus I use it to select the byte within the chips. So here the connection of memory chips to the CPU is going to be have the different address indications. So that is how we are going to tell it is the connection of memory chip to the CPU. Here this configuration gives a memory capacity of 512 bytes of RAM and 512 bytes of ROM. So both are 512 bytes. 512 bytes of RAM we are using and 512 bytes of ROM we are going to use. So it implements the memory map table. So memory map table also will be there, which I'll be going to show you later. So here each RAM receives a 7 lower order bits of the address bit to select one of the 128 possible bytes, right? So that is the purpose of this RAM. So 7 lower order bits. So see here, 1 to 7 is there now. So 1 to 7 lower order bits are going to be given to the RAM. So 1, 2, this is first RAM, second RAM, third RAM and the fourth RAM. Why? Because RAM is of 4 RAMs, 128 into 4, then we'll be going to get the 512. So that's the reason why we have been used the 4 RAMs over here. So RAM capacity of 128 bits only, but we need 512 bits. So that's the reason we have used 4 RAMs over here. And normally the ROM capacity is of 512 bits. No need to use another ROM over here. So here the connection of the memory chip is going to be shown in this diagram. Here the particular RAM chip is selected to determine from lines 8 to 9. So this 8 to 9, so based on this the RAM chip is going to be selected. See here, this 8th pin and 9th pin we have given to the ROM chip. Fine. So this is done through this decoder. Decoder is 2x4 a decoder whose output goes to CS1 input of RAM chip. So that is the purpose of this decoder over here. So when address lines 8 and 9 are equal to 0, so if it is equals to 0 and this is equals to 0, the first RAM chip is going to be selected. So this one is going to be selected. When it is a 0 1, so 0 0 in the sense first RAM chip is going to be selected, 0 1 in the sense second RAM chip is going to be selected, Here, the read and write outputs from the microprocessor are applied to inputs of each RAM. Here, the selection between the RAM and ROM is achieved through bus line 10. See here, this bus line is used for achieving the which RAM to be selected. So this is this assigns address 0 to 512/511 RAM and 512 to 1023 RAM capacity. So this is how the memory connection to CPU is going to be done. So why we have been used 4 RAMs in the sense, like as the RAM capacity is of 128 bits, we need 4 RAMs in order to make the 512 bits. So already the ROM capacity is of 512 bits. So based on 00 in the sense, first RAM will be selected, 01 in the sense, second RAM will be selected, 10 in the sense, third will be selected, and 11 in the sense, fourth RAM will be selected. So based on this number, whichever the RAM we want to connect, that RAM is going to be selected. Right? So this is how the connections to the memory is going to be done when we are going to talk regarding this memory organization. And that's all for today's class, students. So in the next class, we'll be going to come up with another important topic, which is going to be discussed in this third unit. And thank you all, students. Have a great day.